Next, we move on to another topic in gynecology by Dr. Prashita, who happens to be the wife of Dr. Arun Kannan, our previous speaker. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce her to the gathering. She completed her MBBS from Madras Medical College and gynecology from Kasturba Medical College, completed her fellowship in reproductive medicine in MGR University, presently working as a consultant in Garbha Rakshambikai Fertility Center, Kodambakkam, and Cloud 9 Hospital, Tinagar. She has more than 500 cases of induction, oocyte retrieval, and embryo transfer to her credit. She is a best alumni, outgoing alumni student resident award, and research papers she has published, being predicting over ovarian response in IVF and ICSI program, using increase in estradiol in estimation and effect of sperm DNA fragmentation in male infertility. Special interests being all obstetric and gynec procedures, cryotherapy, colposcopy. And she will be talking to us about a case of acute urinary retention in a young female. Over to you, Dr. Prashita. Madam, are you there? You will have to unmute yourself and start your screen share.
She is unmuted now. She is under the name of Prashita. Yes, she started. Can you go to full screen mode, please? Yes, thank you. Please go ahead.
Good evening, everybody. I'm going to do a presentation on acute retention of urine in young female. Our patient is an 18-year-old student. She had a history of travel for 6 hours, following which she was not able to pass urine and had developed acute pain abdomen. She consulted at local 24-hour hospital nearby, and she was catheterized immediately, following which the pain was subsided. She consulted us the next day. She gave history of intermittent pain abdomen and had difficulty in passing urine for 1 week. There was no history of burning or increased frequency or urgency. She also gave history of chronic constipation for 3 years associated with bleeding per rectum, for which she had consulted many doctors and was given symptomatic treatment, the details of which is not known. These symptoms are not associated with fever or vomiting, and there was no history of loss of weight or appetite. Gynecology, she attained menarche at 13 years of age. She had regular cycles, no history of dysmenorrhea or menorrhagia, and her last menstrual period was 15 days back. There was no significant past medical or surgical history and no significant family history. On examination, she is lean built, 40 kg with a BMI of 18. There is no pallor or edema. Her vitals were stable. Breast thyroid examination was normal, and CVS and RS was unremarkable. On abdominal examination, we could find a uniform, smooth midline mass corresponding to 16 to 18 week size of uterus. It was mobile side to side, cystic, and non-tender. The lower border of the mass was not felt, and there was no significant hepatosplenomegaly and no ascites. We did a pararectal examination, and the mass was felt anteriorly, no tenderness, and there was no nodules. The differential diagnosis for such presentation, usually which comes to our mind, is benign ovarian in the reproductive age women. Given a benign ovarian tumor, endometriosis, leiomyoma of uterus, hemorrhagic or simple ovarian cyst, and TVO mass. Otherwise, the most common is retroverted gravid uterus, which was ruled out in this patient because she is regularly menstruating. We did an ultrasound, and here we can see the cavity normally and the uterus normal. And this was the picture in our ultrasound. It was a well-defined 10 into 9 centimeter mass with homogeneous echo pattern. The cystic component is also present in the left side. It is characterized by well-circumcised wall with internal echogenic debris. There was no definite vascularity and color Doppler. The right ovary was clearly visualized, but the left ovary was not clearly visualized. This is the ultra 3D picture of the mass. This type of scan picture, though not a must, but can also be seen in fibroid and hemorrhagic cyst of ovary, an endometrioma, and mucinous cysteinoma. Usually, mucinous cysteinoma is a unilocular, multilocular cyst, but in 24% of cases, we can have unilocular with a ground glass appearance. Keeping in mind these differential diagnoses, we went ahead with investigations. The complete picture was normal. MANTO was negative. Renal function and liver function tests were normal. All the tumor markers, including CEA, CA125, beta HCG, alpha fetoprotein, and lactate dehydrogenase, everything was within the normal limits. We did an MRI, and it showed a large cyst with thin septation in the left pararectal and presacral region. It measures 11 into 9.5 into 9.5 centimeter and displayed hyperintense signal. And I have marked in the right side image, I have marked the uterus. The uterus was stretched but normal. These are both ovaries, which was seen separately from the mass. Since it was not a routine, the report was suggestive of epidermoid, presacral pararectal epidermoid cyst. Since it was not a routine dermoid cyst involving the gonads, we have taken the help of a surgeon who has expertise in this type of cases. And after taking consent for laparoscopy and laparotomy, we proceeded with laparoscopy. In laparoscopy, we saw that the uterus and tubes were normal. And the ovaries were also normal. And the bulge was noticed in the pouch of Douglas in the area shown by the arrow. This slide gives you the comparison of the patient with normal anatomy. The dermoid was exactly located in the... One minute. Sorry for the disturbance. The dermoid... The mass was seen in the rectouterine pouch, and it was seen in between the uterosacrals. So what we did was we made an incision in the rectouterine pouch, and the peritoneum was dissected from the cyst wall with atraumatic grasper and Keelan. In case of ovarian dermoid, we usually insert a self-retaining endobag and place it beneath the ovary and do cystectomy. And if in case we have a spill, it usually falls in the endobag. But it was not in this case, because it was in the rectouterine pouch. We were not able to pass the bag there. And unfortunately, the sebaceous material with hair strands spilled in the peritoneum. The dissection was done carefully not to injure the rectum below. And this was aided by placing we put a finger in the rectum and the vagina, guiding the surgeon. The cyst wall was completely removed, and then the contents aspirated thoroughly. The video after the complete removal of cyst wall and the complete peritoneal lavage. The peritoneal lavage was done using warm saline. Use of cold irrigation fluid may not only, yeah, but it will also make retrieval challenging by solidifying the fat-rich contents. Following complete lavage, which was done multiple times, we placed Surgicel in the dead space. And the HPV was consistent with dermoid cyst. Dermoid cyst, the incidence rate of dermoid cyst is 1.2 to 14.2 in 100,000 females, of which less than 10% are in the retroperitoneum. It is most commonly seen during reproductive age. Dermoid cysts are embryonic, arising from all three germ cell layers, and are principally usually encountered in the gonads, but rarely localized in the extragonadal sites such as stomach, liver, or retroperitoneum. It usually causes lower abdominal pain, which occurs in nearly half of the patient. Other rare symptoms are nausea, vomiting, constipation, urinary retention, and hydrolipidemia are less common symptoms. The complications include torsion of the cyst, rupture, malignant formation, which is very rare, and infection. The symptoms of retroperitoneal masses are usually asymptomatic, diagnosed when they reach huge size and cause pressure symptoms to the adjacent organs. It can cause radicular back pain, or it can cause nausea, vomiting, colicky pain, and retention. When the mass grows huge, it can also compress aorta and IVC. This is the ultrasound feature specific to dermoid cyst. The first picture shows the tip of iceberg sign. The echogenic cyst that contains sebum and hair cause marked posterior acoustic attenuation as shown in the arrow, so that only the superficial part of the cyst is seen, just like the tip of iceberg. This is Rokitansky nodule. It's a cystic lesion with a densely echogenic tubercle projecting in the cystic lumen. This is the dermoid mesh, which refers to the hyperechogenic lines arising from the hair. So whether we have to proceed with laparoscopy or laparotomy. Laparoscopic cystectomy is the desired when facility and expertise are available. Though laparoscopic cystectomy of dermoid cyst is associated with greater intraoperative cyst rupture, particularly when the size is greater than 7 cm. The cyst rupture is rarely associated with complications, and therefore minimally invasive surgical management of dermoid cyst is a reasonable surgical approach. Laparotomy causes postoperative additions, which may result in mechanical infertility in women of reproductive age. The risk of spillage is reported to be 40 to 50%, even up to 75% during laparoscopic cystectomy, and it is less in case of laparotomy. Despite the increased risk of rupture, in the adult literature, the chemical peritonitis has been found to occur with an estimated incidence of only 0.2% following laparoscopic cyst excision of a mature cystic teratoma if the spillage is managed by immediate copious lavage. Though this slide is not relevant to this case, as an infertility specialist, I would like to discuss the management of ovarian dermoid. Cystectomy has been established to be a safe method for tumor removal in the adult and pediatric population as oophorectomy. No need of wedge biopsy of the contralateral ovary, because only 1.1% of normal looking contralateral ovary has proven histological teratoma. Given the good predictive rate of ultrasound and careful inspection of the contralateral ovary at the time of surgery, it offers a safe alternative to wedge biopsy. The reported incidence of recurrent mature cystic teratoma following cystectomy is only 3 to 4%. So we can safely proceed with cystectomy than oophorectomy. The amount of ovarian tissue remaining can dramatically impact future fertility and is an important consideration in the management of mature cystic teratoma in young women. Chemical peritonitis. The most dreaded complication of dermoid cyst removal is the chemical peritonitis. It is an aseptic inflammatory peritoneal reaction, and a patient present with fever, guarding, and rigidity in the postoperative period. Our patient, though had spillage, did not develop chemical peritonitis due to adequate lavage. Prolonged chemical peritonitis rarely results in the formation of granuloma in the peritoneum, otherwise known as granulomatous peritonitis. Chronic granulomatous peritonitis is one of the catastrophic complications caused by intraoperative leakage of dermoid cyst content, and this condition often appears along with severe adhesions and ascites that resemble tuberculous peritonitis or malignancy. And this can present even after 1 year of surgery. The treatment of acute chemical peritonitis includes early conservative surgical approach with laparoscopy, involving removal of peritoneal granuloma and copious lavage, which can result in successful treatment of advanced chemical peritonitis. This is a flowchart by RCOG for the management of adnexal mass. In case of emergency acute abdomen, we directly proceed with the laparoscopy in the suspicion of torsion. If the patient is asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic, the management depends upon the size and the nature, the complexity of the cyst. If the cyst is complex, we have to do tumor markers, and if there is high suspicion of cancer, gynecology department. If the tumor markers are negative, but still in case of complexes, when it is more than 5 cm, we proceed with laparoscopy. And in simple cysts less than 5 cm, reassurance and rescan is important. If the cyst is 5 to 7 cm and asymptomatic, we can always scan after 3 months. If it resolves, we'll leave it as such. If it is persistent, we'll proceed with tumor markers and then decide on surgery. If the cyst is symptomatic, we should directly do tumor markers and proceed with surgery. And cysts greater than 7 cm should be tumor markers and further evaluation has to be done. And if needed, surgery has to be done. If the patient wants to delay surgery due to fertility issues, we can still wait and rescan after 3 months. Take home points are chronic symptoms, like in this case, constipation, should not be ignored and needs detailed evaluation. Need of appropriate imaging and based on the findings, a multidisciplinary approach by gynecologist, surgeon, urologist, if needed, has to be done and depends on every. We have to be vigilant for malignant tumors and perform ovarian sparing surgery for suspected Dunbar cysts are mostly benign. Treatment is by cystectomy and should use minimally invasive procedure considering the physical and mental well-being of young patients. Thank you. I thank IME Kodumbakkam for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam. There is a question in the chat box. What are the recurrent rates of the such dermoid cysts? Sorry.
For the recurrence of dermoid cysts is 3-4%. Even after removal. That's okay. Cystectomy is performed than oophorectomy because the recurrence risk rate is very less. And usually it occurs in young women. And hence, it is better to perform cystectomy than removal of the ovary.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. And one more question. Any specific precautions have you taken to identify the ureter on that side?
No. The ureter is more anteriorly because it was in the pre-sacral region. We didn't think of putting a stent before surgery because the MRI was suggestive of pre-sacral and pararectal. We didn't decide on the ureter.